front CBD and ampullary, periampullary region anatomy before we launch into the cases. But first, let me see whether I can, in fact, show the cases. So what I'll do is I'll try to share my screen.
Yes.
And you need to tell me whether... So share screen is here. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, we can.
So you're able to see that. Okay. That's good. There's some drawing tools available. I've never used Zoom before. Are there any drawing tools available here or...
No, actually, you can use your drawing tools in your own computer.
Oh, in the computer.
That will be seen.
Yeah. Okay, okay. Right. So, what I'll do is, I will go on to the PPT. Is this also visible to everybody?
No, see, you can only show one of them. This is your, we can see your computer screen.
You can see the computer screen.
Yes.
So, are you able to see the PPT slides now that I'm showing, or you are seeing the whole all of the computer screen?
All of the computer screen. Yeah.
Are you able to see the slides which I am going through now?
No, no. Then you have to come out of the
share
screen.
From here.
Come out of the share screen and then share the slides alone.
Okay, new share.
That's right.
So, we'll do a new share of this. And
that's right. Now we can see.
Now you can see.
Full screen. Yeah.
Now you can see. Okay.
Very simple. So,
yeah. So, we are just going to, basically, I'm just going to remind myself about what it is I need to talk today. So, when a patient comes to us with an ultrasound report of a dilated biliary system with an entire bile duct dilated right up to the end. We are always needing to rule out lower end cancer, either in the CBD or is it in the ampulla of Vater or duodenum or pancreas. Basically, it would be nice to figure out where the epicenter of the cancer is, because ampullary cancers are supposed to have a better prognosis, I'm told. So, if we look at the anatomy down here, this is something that we can show on CT scan, exactly the anatomy like this. And we do know that the CBD and MPD join up like in this way in majority. Maybe with a very short segment joining in 38%. Separate openings is supposed to be very less. Very long channel is even less. So when we look at, when we are trying to assess the ampullary region on CT, these are the various parts that we are basically trying to see. We are trying to look at the ampulla, which should look like that. We should see the wall of the ampulla this way against the background of the submucosa of the duodenum. And then we see the pancreas nicely touching the duodenum over there. That's a duodenal wall and the CBD. And when the ampulla is collapsed, it should show up like that. So this is what we are trying to see. And what we want to assess is whether there is a tumor, where the tumor is, whether the tumor is inside of the ampulla or the tumor is invading the duodenal wall or invading the pancreas or invades the peripancreatic soft tissues, and what the adenopathy is. So if I can go back there, and if I need to start drawing using some things from here. So So that draw tool is not there, but I can insert a shape and try to show. So this is how a tumor would look inside, okay, the inside of the ampulla. So if we can, so that is a very thin line, isn't it? So that would look like that inside of the ampulla. Now, if the tumor were to go out of the ampulla, it would look like this. So essentially, I have to make a scan which will show this mucosa, submucosa, and the wall of the ampulla. That's how I need to scan my patient, and that's how I need to demonstrate it. So that's the job at hand, basically. What is the other thing that I need to show? Is it adherent to anything? So the surgeon would like to know whether these vessels are, you know, involved at all. And so these are the basic things that I need to show. Now, there are certain patterns of ampullary cancers which can be seen on CT. So this is a nodular mass forming type. So you can see that there's a nodule right there at the ampulla. So if we look at it, is the arrow visible?
Yes, it is.
Okay. So I am going to show the contour of the duodenum. So this is the contour of the duodenum over here. This dull looking thing over here. And this bright, bright structure over here is the, of course, the head pancreas. What we see over here, even brighter, is of course the superior mesenteric artery with the jejunal branches coming off, and one replaced right hepatic artery getting out from the SMA and going towards the liver over there. Now, this is a mass. We can see it's a dull looking mass, not enhancing much, but it is small. And we can see that's the CBD, that's the MPD. The adjacent to the mass, we see that there's a dark line. So we know that the mass has not crossed over to involve either the pancreas or the CBD or the MPD. This dark line is actually the wall of the duodenum. So we know that it has not crossed out of the duodenal wall at all. So I'll show you. So here you can see that there's an inset over here where we are showing that a zoomed up image of the same thing again. Duodenum, that's the nodule, the mass, CBD and MPD, and how brightly the pancreas is enhancing. So now this particular image highlights the importance of the arterial phase in CT. If we make a scan with only one venous phase, a plain scan and a venous phase scan, it is impossible to differentiate between these various structures that we are talking about, because all will be one same shade of gray. Now, here is another case. We can see the extremely dilated CBD, the MPD. This is the pancreas. This is the lumen of the duodenum. This is one wall of the duodenum, the lateral wall. This is the medial wall of the duodenum. And if you look carefully, you'll realize that there is a tiny button of increased enhancement over there. It's a very, very tiny cancer. Of course, no credit to us for picking this up, because the ducts are so dilated. Everybody knows that there is a cancer out there. So even though it is really small, we are able to pick it up because it is enhancing in a separate way from the duodenal wall. The wall is normal, wall is dull. This is brighter. Now, this is a portal venous phase. This is just after the arterial phase, we make this phase. So here also you can see that the pancreas is enhancing, not as much as the arterial phase, but still enhancing. Here the cancer is enhancing little more than the duodenal wall. So the point I'm trying to make is that multiphasic CT helps us to separate out various tissues from diseased tissue, and helps us to identify the contour of the cancer, and therefore its leading edge onto the pancreas or onto the bile duct, pancreatic duct, or outside of the duodenal wall. Now, here is another case, just a diagrammatic representation. It's a really bulgy mass lesion over there. Now, this is, of course, an oblique section where we are able to get the entire common bile duct in one plane, along with a bit of the pancreatic duct, and then the mass, and also the duodenum. So if we go back to the previous image, if you see, that's the bile duct, pancreatic duct, and mass, and duodenum and pancreas, and you have anatomy that you are seeing in that diagram. So here comes the use of the workstation or the manipulation of the image in such a way that it is in an understandable plane, a plane that the surgeon would easily understand. So if we give an odd plane where only part of the bile duct is seen or part of the duodenum is seen, it is very difficult to relate to the various anatomies. So this is a zoomed up thing, and we can see over there, there's lots of stuff happening over here. Actually, a lot of tissues have been separated. So this is the duodenal wall, the normal thin duodenal wall over here. There is this huge bulky mass over here. There is a line over here. I have no idea what that is actually. We didn't get a path, this thing on it, but rather a smooth looking mass going right out of the duodenal wall. Completely, gone through and through. You can see this is the duodenal wall here. It's gone through and through. So definitely it is invaded outside the duodenum. And maybe a bit of the ducts also. So this is the same mass in axial section. You can see that the mass, that's the duodenal wall over here, and the mass crosses that and goes somewhere out. And on this phase, you will realize how terribly difficult it is to differentiate whether this mass is infiltrating the pancreas or not. This is a venous phase, and more or less the mass enhances the same as pancreas. Where the mass ends or where its leading edge is very hard to tell. Maybe if you strain, you can see one dark line over here and you know that this is pancreas. So at this point particularly, the mass may not have infiltrated the pancreas. But if you look over here, it is more shaggy. So it's not very clear whether it has done that or not done that. So what I will do is I will get out of this PowerPoint now and I will get on to a case. So I will say new share and screen. So are you able to see me live scrolling?
Yes, very much.
So what I'm going to show you first is a plain scan. So this is a plain scan of a gentleman who comes with the jaundice, and I have the data sheet here which says that, ultrasound was suspecting some stones at the lower end of the CBD. Some shadows were there. And taste of obstructive jaundice. So we were asked to evaluate on CT. So on the plain scan,
your voice is the sound is distorted, Ruchita, your speaker sound.
What I'll do is I will switch off the video, maybe my video, okay. Then you can hear me better. Stop video. Okay. So is my voice a little clearer now?
No, it's the same. We want the video on anyway.
The video on? Okay. All right. Is my voice, does it continue to be distorted?
Yeah.
Still distorted?
No, you carry on. We'll see how it goes.
Okay. What do you mean distorted? Is it low or
No. I mean, there's some aberration.
Aberrant voice.
It's a rugged sort of a thing.
Rugged voice. Right. Okay. So, but you are able to see the screen and
yes,
somewhat
okay.
able to hear me. Okay. So maybe my voice is a bit rugged today. But so what you can see over here is this biliary dilatation. This is a plain scan, and as we come down, we can see that everything is, you know, dull, and we are at the lower end of the CBD over here. And if there was a stone over here, it would be the density of the bone or right density. So, I'm going to go to the arterial phase. What I'll do is, I do know what is causing an interference, but I'll keep my phone in the next room. Okay, I'm sorry for that interruption. Okay, I'm back. Can you hear me any better?
Mane, it's the same, Dr. Vista. Please continue. We'll see. We hope it will become all right on its own.
Okay. So, this we are showing you now the arterial phase. You can see that the is bright, you pacify. These are the vessels. That's the SMA coming out, and this is the celiac artery coming out. But what I want to draw your attention to is the pancreas is quite bright too.
Someone has suggested that the team viewer needs to be stopped. Team viewer.
I'm showing it to you from the team viewer.
Oh, okay. Then that's fine. Yeah, can.
Done is I have logged on into my hospital computer through team viewer, and I am showing it
fine.
Live. Yeah. So we can see that the pancreas is enhancing nicely over here. This is a bright pancreas. So, it's quite dilated. That's the common bile duct. We are going to take a long view or a coronal view. And here we are. So, we can see that main pancreatic duct is also dilated significantly, and the CBD is also dilated, and there is something at the end of it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rotate it for you to get an understanding of how this can actually be in the plane of the disease. So this is how we do it. We in the plane of the disease, and that's the large mass over there, which you can see the. There, that's the mass, and this is the dilated CBD MPD, and here is the mass. So now, what we will do is we will take a. So I'm just going through steps of how we look at ampullary mass and come to a conclusion about the staging of it. So this is the mass on axial section. So this is the duodenum, this is the cava, this is the aorta, and this bright structure over here is the pancreas. So we can see that the mass does not involve the pancreas, because the pancreas maintains its brightness and its distinctness from the duodenum. but the mass appears to involve the thickness of the duodenal wall. So this is the duodenal wall. If you change the duodenal wall, at this point we don't see the duodenal wall. So then I will take you through the photorenal phase, which is another phase where we expect the mass to enhance a bit more. So the mass has enhanced, and what has happened also luckily for us is that the duodenum has filled up with water. So before we start, we give some water to the patient, hoping that it will reach the duodenum. We also give a little bit of buscopan, and so that the duodenum doesn't peristalt as much. And so now this mass has enhanced a little more, and you can see that it is. Now the submucosal plane of the duodenum is visible. So if we look carefully, we can see three layers over here. This is the mucosa, and the dark part is the submucosa, and that's the mass actually. So if we can obtain our scan, now here it is not very, very sharp because the patient is breathing. So the patient was breathing through the scan, and therefore we have a little bit of blurriness. But if we can get this kind of a anatomy differentiation, then and only then can we actually stage the tumor. There is no way this tumor can be staged in routine actual corneal sagittal disease. It is extremely difficult. We go to the final venous phase where everything enhances. And try to look for. So we see here the mass is enhanced further a little bit more. So it is standing out a little bit brighter, thankfully. And we can see that it is just located inside of the ampulla, but not involving the pancreas, but going through the duodenal wall over there. And as far as nodes are concerned, we can see that there are nodes over here. Over there, these are around the celiac artery, these are small nodes. We also find some nodes over here. Just above the head pancreas, that's another node. And if we go behind the head pancreas, we find some nodes also. So that is always better seen in the axial scan. So we see the dilated biliary tree, the common bile duct, we see the portal vein there, and we can see more or less the fat planes are all clear. And there we see this bright mass. Now it has brightened up so much. It must be having some fibrous tissue, which enhances more in the venous space. And through and through involvement of the duodenum, in the sense the whole wall of the duodenum, but not involving the pancreas. And there are those nodes over there. Other than that, of course, we analyze for liver mets, which we don't have in this patient. And distant metastasis, peritoneal involvement. We go right down to the cul-de-sac and pelvis and see if there is any peritoneal thickening, a little bit of ascites over there. And that is not there at all. So basically, we have staged this tumor to T2N2 M0. So that's how we would characterize the lesion as a cancer, find its extent and then the nodal status, and whether there is any replaced right hepatic artery. So here, the other exercise which we also do is that if there is a replaced right hepatic artery which is traversing through the head pancreas, we need to demonstrate that also. So how we do that is, we take a good arterial maximum intensity projection, which is like that and see where from the hepatic artery is arising, and clearly the hepatic artery, which is this one, is arising from the celiac and not from the SMA, like I showed on the PowerPoint. So there is no fear of a replaced hepatic from there coming in the way of the Whipple surgery. So basically, these are some of the things that we do to assess these patients. Now, would the moderator like to say anything, or anybody wants to discuss anything?
I think the basic the basic thing about the ampullary tumor is that most of the time the local staging is not a tumor, because most of them will be either in the duodenum or in the hepatopancreas without much involvement of the major vessels. But I think it's more useful for the pancreatic head cancer. I think you can go ahead with the rest of the talk in the lower part.
Okay. So I have one more case to show. I'll pull up that case. So what we have here is a lady, 55-year-old lady who's a known case of periampullary cancer. And this is a scenario which is a kind of a...
Can you share the screen?
Yeah, I'll share the screen.
Now, will you be able to make out whether that is a malignancy or a benign condition or a neuroendocrine or anything of that nature?
Most of these cancer and most of these lesions are malignant. They enhance in a their shape itself is different from a benign lesion. So a benign lesion would be villous adenoma, mostly from the it will be hanging down into the duodenum. It will be like a polypoid, and it will be surface. It will not be so much inside of the ampulla. The ampullary lesions that we see within the ampulla, or these kind of enhancing lesions with these contours, infiltrating edges, are all mostly malignant only. Neuroendocrine tumors are not very difficult to differentiate. They are enormously enhancing. Enormously enhancing. In fact, I do have one neuroendocrine tumor which I can show you. So,
no, you can continue with this, and then the time comes, you can show that.
Okay. So then I'll continue with this. Yeah. So can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Yes, you can. Okay. I have chosen this case is because there's a stent in the CVD. This is a really difficult thing for us radiologists to do, because there is a cancer. There is a stent inside, and the stent usually throws a lot of artifacts. It's very hard to stage a cancer anywhere in the bile duct or in the region of the ampulla with a bright stent within it. So I'm just going to show how this one can be seen actually. So straight away I'll go to the arterial phase, and we see that the biliary tree is quite collapsed because of the functioning stent within it. So this bright thing within the this is the CBD, which has air within it because of the stent, and there's a bright stent inside of that. Now we come to the lower end, and here is a problem. As we can see, the papilla has been cut, and that means the cancer is cut and the stent is introduced inside. So this is very, very challenging because the anatomy gets fully distorted. It's not the way we expect to see it. So even then, we will make an attempt to see how we can, you know, make some sense of this. So we are now in the coronal mode, and we can see that that is a bright thing, is a stent. The pancreas is nicely and brightly enhancing. This is the supramesenteric artery. We can see that the pancreatic duct is also dilated, and there is the liver and the ampulla over there. I'm going to try to align myself to the ampulla. The moment I do that, you can see that the stent is coming in the way, and I'm not getting any sense of how this mass is going. The mass. So now if you zoom it up, we have to focus on the normal part of the anatomy. So when we look at the normal duodenal wall, which is this, it's a very thin wall. And then when we come towards the other wall, here we can see that there is an enhancing mass. And then again here, this part is enhancing differently from the duodenum. So now if you look at the lesion, we can see a little bit of a polypoid growth which has gone into the main pancreatic. So I'm not sure that you're able to appreciate it, but here it is, just growing upwards into the NPD. Likewise, there is a part of the CDD which is snugly catching the stent, which is this portion. Above that, it is capacious, and suddenly there is a snug fit, and there is a bit of a grayness over here, very much separate from the pancreatic tissue, which is this brightly enhancing tissue. So basically, if I were to draw it, I cannot draw it on this view because I am oblique, so I will have to draw with this. So if I were to draw it out, this is how far the mass is gone. Comes down here, gets into the thing here. Here it tears a bit and creeps along here, and I can see that this is coming, and then the stent enters it, and then that's the mass. So we know that the mass has infiltrated the pancreas. It's infiltrating a bit of the CBD, lower end CBD, bit of the MBD also, and definitely is going outside the duodenal wall over there. So this is the importance of this phase of contrast, and this is why we do a multiphasic CT scan. The importance of a multiphasic CT scan. So when you are sending your patients across for you know, evaluating these kind of cases, you need to send it somewhere where they are doing it like this. Otherwise, if they are just doing one phase of contrast and the plane scan, this will not be possible to show. As you can see here, already the mass and pancreas are enhancing almost more or less the same way. Very difficult to differentiate on this phase. Then we look for nodes. And straight away, just as I made, you can see that there is a node over there that is just above the renal vein. There is one iotocable node here just below the renal vein. Here, two, three nodes are there, two, three nodes are over there. And then, of course, alongside the portal vein, there are nodes here. So, there are plenty of nodes for this patient, for all the stations. Because there's an aortocable node, we have called it, we have staged it to T3B N2 M1. And multiple nodes are there. So this is how we did manage to stage it. It was a bit challenging to get that, but because the mass was very big, we were able to actually see it with the, despite the stent being inside. If the mass is small, then you know it would be very challenging to stage these lesions. So this is how much I will show today, and we can go on to any discussions that you all would like to make. I need to stop sharing, I think. Stop sharing. Yeah. I'm going to shut the TV down and let me see whether we can hear ourselves better.
Okay. I think the internet speed and
am I better audible now?
No,
yeah, you are audible.
The same, no.
There is some.
So. That's about how much you know. I'm sure there is anything that you would any issues about these kind of lesions that you do or problems with the staging, whether you want to do an MRI or you want to do a CT scan, or you want to do MRCP, that kind of discussion we can have. What do you surgeons generally prefer to do when you have these cases?
Now we've always
ampullary tumor.
Yeah, lower end.
Yeah, when we see ampullary tumor, yeah, the surgical treatment for these sort of tumors are pancreatic duodenectomy. So we have two sets of issues, one related to the tumor stage and second related to the aberrant anatomy and all. I think both are important when we plan surgical treatment for patients with ampullary lesions. But one thing is sure, it is very important to differentiate a malignant tumor from benign tumor because more and more endoscopists are doing ampullectomy. So we can avoid a mutilating surgery if that is the situation. Second thing about the presence of lymph nodes which you identified on the CT scan. Is there any option to differentiate a malignant nodal mets from a benign inflammatory lesion which you can always see in patients with obstructive jaundice? I think the interventions and simple obstructive jaundice will produce a lot of lymph nodes inside the abdomen. That can actually affect the staging. So is there any method to differentiate these two?
That one is really tough. But what we go by is that, you know, if the node is enhancing heterogeneously, it is a cancer node. If it's a homogeneous, smooth, moderately enhancing node, no necrosis, no coalescence, no stickiness to each other, that may be a reactive node. And once there's a stent inside, also all kinds of reactive nodes come up. So if it's a round, large, heterogeneous, this is a classical teaching. But then we have had nodes, you know, which are small nodes, homogeneous, but yet they turn out to be positive. Problem we have wherever there is this, the cancer itself throws some reactive nodes or intervention throws some reactive nodes. Like even in cancer rectum also we have the same problem. The cancer itself throws up reactive nodes. So this performs poorly. I think there's some 70 to 80% sensitivity of picking up these nodes correctly. But really large heterogeneous nodes are there. Like for example, the nodes I showed you. They were shaggy. They were irregular surfaces. They were irregularly shaped. So those are definitely reactive nodes. I mean, metastatic nodes. And iotocaval nodes will not come, you know, in reactive nodes. Those ones are very dangerous. I think those one should suspect.
Krishna, I have a request. Would you log out and log in again?
I will log out.
And log in again, please. Then we see whether the voice is correct. Yeah, Pradhaman, meantime.
Yes, sir.
See, these days actually it's become very fashionable for people to go for a PET CT straight up. Yeah, I think Rajit is back. I hope voice is clearer now. Yeah. See, I mean, what is your comment on that? Well, I think she's back. Rajit, we hope the voice is clearer now, but the image is brighter, definitely.
I switched on a light. Is my voice clear?
What have you done? Now the voice is crystal clear.
That's because I logged out and logged back in. You should have suggested earlier.
No, but because, yeah, I should have actually. Now, my question, I was just, since you're away, I was asking Pradhaban, that these days, you know, because a lot of these patients are seen by physicians first thing they do when seeing malignant is PET CT.
Right. Do you need a PET CT or don't need a PET CT?
I don't need, because I always believe, I'm sure you agree with me, that the CT imaging in a PET CT is a lot inferior than a conventional CCT, is what I believe. The physicians do that. I'm sure you would have come across situations like that. What is your take on that?
You know, I feel that a PET CT team may not always have a dedicated specialist in a particular region. Like they may not have an abdominal radiologist doing the CT part of it. And a PET CT, ideally, the CT is used only to localize the, increased uptake or whatever, the hot areas. So a plain CT should work over there. And the contrast should be reserved for doing a targeted, a tailored study is what I always feel. There are certain cancers which don't really metastasize all over the body. You know, what is your... protocols or guidelines say? Do they say that in periampullary cancers you need to do a PET CT?
No.
You don't, right?
My second question, Pradhaman, before you come in, is so very commonly we see that the ultrasound shows the bilet is dilated till the lower end and there's nothing seen over there. And endoscopy also may show a prominent ampulla or might not show that. We do not know what is causing, and a good number of cases, this is stricture lower end of CBD, which we do not know what is it. How do you help in that those times? I'm sure Pradhaman would have come across situations like that. Stricture lower end, we don't know what is the cause.
Stricture lower end, if you don't know what is the cause.
In a patient.
Yeah.
Sorry, go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah, Pradhaman.
Yeah. In a patient who is having dilated duct, having dilated duct and symptomatic without high chance of ampullary tumor, because around 30-40% of patients in whom the preoperative biopsy, side wing endoscopy, all were negative for an ampullary lesion or a mass, finally they will come back as malignancy after pancreatic duodenectomy when we do the resections. So if we do repeated imaging, if we do repeated ERCP, actually we are increasing the chance of recurrence on those lesions. Actually, your investigation actually prolongs the strain on treating those patients, and as actually you are losing a patient in the resectable stage. I think if there is a dilated bile duct with obstructive jaundice, even if there is only very small lesion or a bulgy ampulla seen, there is a high chance that it is having a malignancy in the ampulla.
Does PET CT help here?
No, not in my opinion. It does not help.
PET, when...
But the second question is, in patients with chronic pancreatitis. That's another area. You know, we have had quite a few patients in the recent past. They're losing weight. Imaging is not able to say. There's some sort of a mass in the head area. It looks like inflammatory, acute and chronic. How will you differentiate? How will you make out that the malignancy has arisen in a carcinoma pattern, the chronic pancreatitis, and causing obstruction of the ampullary area?
On imaging?
On imaging, yes.
Okay, so this is a nightmare, absolutely. This is one of the toughest of tough things that we ever are asked to do, because the whole pancreas is completely distorted and full of calcium, and inside of that, you're looking for a cancer. The only advantage of this kind of a lesion, or a good thing about it, is that for us basically is that it'll be somewhere in the head, and it will basically the pancreas will be shrunken, and this will form a sort of a mass. So we basically go into it looking for a contour bulge, because this pancreas it has all shrunken completely. So we look for a contour bulge, we look for an abnormal shape, and we look for an abnormal enhancement. Sometimes one investigation may not give it to you. For example, a CT may not give you the answer, but an MR with a diffusion weighted imaging may give you the answer. So you might need to do two exams in that. Nevertheless, it will be difficult and challenging, and always, always to compare with previous studies. So carefully go through the earlier CT and then this one and compare and see where the distortion has happened. So this is definitely very challenging and very a litigatory completely issue where we can get totally caught, you know.
Madam, I have a few suggestions regarding chronic pancreatitis. Actually, we see different types of chronic pancreatitis. When you have edematous pancreas in alcoholic pancreatitis, the pancreatic contour may be different, where the individual acinae will be swollen and there will be small stones. And in those situations, the chances of developing inflammatory masses are high. But in chronic pancreatitis of the tropic, we see larger masses, more atrophy of the gland. Sometimes the gland may be replaced by fat. So when the pancreas is completely replaced by fat, if we see an area of enhancement in the fat, that is representing an area of malignancy.
Correct.
That is one point which I can. Second, patient with chronic pancreatitis of tropic having a dilated bile duct, most of the time they turn out to be a malignant rather than an inflammatory stricture or benign thing. So third point is patients with fibrotic type of pancreatic chronic pancreatitis, they have a smaller gland compared to the rest of the patients, but they have more chance of an inflammatory stricture compared to the what we call the fat replacement gland. So the malignancy risk is higher in those with fat replacement. So these are the findings, because we have seen quite a number of patients with CCP and CA pancreas.
Okay. So there was a query from somebody who said how to find superior mesenteric, replace right hepatic artery on axial. There was a message, but now I'm not seeing that message anymore. Should I answer that?
Yes, yes, please.
Yeah, you can.
So basically, you have to actually go looking for the hepatic arteries in all these cases which are going for a Whipple's. So what you need to do is start from the top near the liver hilum, and on axial, chase down the hepatic arteries right up to the origin. If it is going past the celiac artery and entering towards the head pancreas, you know it is arising from the SMA. So start from the liver and chase the hepatic arteries, each one, right, segment 4, left, and then come down. Then you should be able to find.
Now, what is this pancreas protocol? Because this is a very common question that is asked to the GI surgery postgraduates from your point of view.
So pancreas protocol is like a triphasic, triple phase of contrast, where you take an arterial phase, which is where you get the aorta, SMA, as well as the pancreas enhancing brightly. It usually comes about 25 seconds after injection of contrast, rapid injection of contrast with a pressure injector. You may inject at 4 ml or 4.5 ml per second. So in 25 seconds, we get an arterial phase. Then what we take is an early venous phase, so which is about 45 seconds post-contrast injection, 45 to 50 seconds. Here also, the pancreas retains a lot of the contrast and a lot of its brightness. And the final phase, which we take, we call the hepatic venous or the late venous phase, comes at about 70 to 80 seconds post-contrast enhancement. So the chance of differentiating the various layers of the duodenal wall, the pancreas, the bile duct, and the arteries and nodes is very high with these protocols. So that is why it's called pancreatic protocol. Each department will have their own, a little bit of a variation. Like some people will take a little earlier arterial phase, little later venous phase, something like that. But they standardize their lab. So they know how the cancer looks in which phase, and they are able to perform the scan that way and give you the report that way. So this is basically triphasic pancreatic protocol.
Are we continuing with the next session? No. Pancreatic cancers,
which I am not talking anymore today.
Today, yeah. Next session will be head malignancies. And see, actually, I feel nobody will have a bigger collection than Rochita when it comes to any of the GI abdominal malignancies. I mean, take some effort to get some of them together. But this is a wonderful session about preamplic. Any questions from anyone else from the audience, please? Unmute yourself and feel free to ask. Anyone? So we'll be glad if you give us a series of lectures. because people should know such beautiful images exist, and you know there's a way to interpret, because most of us are accustomed to not so great pictures, and it's not just the machine, but it's the mind behind the machine which matters. And you know, that's what we've experienced when we worked with her. Pradhaban?
Yes, sir. I think it was a wonderful session altogether, because I am seeing for first time such a beautiful image, on even though I have done more than 450 of so pancreatic duodenectomies. So I think the collection which Apollo Dr. Ruchida has, it is wonderful. So it was a nice session, I think questions, because this is a golden opportunity for them to interact. Okay, I think they're not utilizing the
they just started knowing her now. So anyway, this is going live in Learning General Surgery as well. And of course, this is high-end radiology and high-end surgery as well, not for general surgeons. But they should understand that such wonderful things exist.
Yeah, with this sort of images, I think the simple staging laparotomy, which happened most of the time in the earlier phase, I think it will not happen further, because the radiologist will give you a correct guide whether to operate or not.
Precisely, that's what, see, she any emergency imaging, she says, please operate. And once she says operate, we'll operate. She knows that then, as and when we are finishing the surgery, there'll be a telephone call. What are the findings? You know, I mean, that's the involvement which should be there in radiologists, and that makes surgery is such a wonderful thing. Thanks,
sir. I think that surgeons can innovate more when they get more information. So rather than being challenged on table, you can do so much more. Some cases are just written off and called inoperable. They are not actually, you can actually operate on them. So we radiologists should do our bit to, improve the patient outcomes is what I feel. This session for me was really nice because of the opportunity to interact with you. Otherwise, radiology meetings that we are doing, webinars, we don't have clinicians there, and sometimes I get bored, and I should not say that. It's very bad of me to say that, but I love it when clinicians are there and I'm able to interact. So we'll bring some more sessions with you if that's good for you.
Definitely. We'll be looking forward to them. Thank you so much. Thanks for spending your Saturday evening with us, and it's been wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Ruchida. Thanks, Pradhaban. We'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.